Development of critical software systems should meet high security and reliability requirements. This is not surprising. Such systems are used in medicine, automotive industry, space industry, and other industry fields where a programmatic error could cause large financial losses or even cause human lives. The MISRA standard is designed for such safety-critical systems. In this video, you will learn what the MISRA standard is and how to use it when writing projects in C and C++. But first, we'd really appreciate your support. Subscribe to our channel so as not to miss our future videos. Like I said, the MISRA standard applies to the development of critical systems in C and C++ languages. Critical systems often mean embedded systems. The purpose of the standard is to improve security, portability, and reliability of critical software systems. The MISRA C rules are split into three categories. Mandatory, the stringent rules. You must not violate these rules under any circumstances. Required, these are less strict rules. They improve the code readability, prohibit unsafe language constructs, and forbid functions whose incorrect use leads to failures. And advisory, these are non-obligatory recommendations. MISRA C++ is a bit different. It doesn't have the mandatory category, and most of the rules belong to the required category. There is also the document category. These are mandatory rules related to general practices, such as all use of assembler must be documented, or all library code shall conform to MISRA C++. Now, let's see how the standard works on real code examples. Let's look at a few required rules, since this category is the largest. A cache should not remove any const volatile qualification from the type that is pointed to by a pointer or a reference. The rule warns that this pattern leads to undefined behavior. Octal constants should not be used. The rule says that the use of octal literals could hinder code readability, especially when a developer is scheming through code. Misinterpreting numeric values may result in various mistakes. Conversions should not be performed between pointer to function and any other type. The pointer fp12 function takes the address of the foo function, whose arguments and return value do not match the one of the fp1 pointer. The language standard allows such conversions, however, the MISRA C standard warns that they cause undefined behavior. MISRA is not just a set of rules. The standard also describes what it was created for and why C or C++ was chosen. There's more. The standard contains a huge number of tips on what you must know before taking on a certain task. For example, how to set up the development process according to MISRA, how to use static analyzers for checking the code for compliance, what documents you need to maintain, how to fill them out, and so on. But don't worry. The standard also provides a few checklists that help you sort out all this bureaucracy. Let's say you are going to write a program for a critical system, or you already have a program, but you need to check it for MISRA compliance. How can you do that? Do you really have to do it manually? It turns out you have to carefully look through each line of code and even know the standard by heart. Sounds crazy, to be honest. In this case, the PVS Studio team and the MISRA developers themselves advise using static analysis to test your code. The program performs the entire check for you. You simply run the analyzer and get a report of potential violations of the standard. After that, you study the report and fix the bugs. At what point should you start using MISRA? Safe to say, the sooner the better. Ideally, before you start writing code at all. This way, it will be easier to follow the rules throughout your code's entire lifecycle. But what if the project is partially or completely ready? In this case, you will need to thoroughly refactor the existing code. Most likely, when you run the analyzer, it will show you dozens or hundreds of warnings. No wonder if you get a little confused. After all, the code that you added recently will simply get lost in this big bunch of warnings. Yes, this happens quite often during the first check of the project. Baselining solves the problem. Baselining is the mechanism of the PV Studio Analyzer that allows you to mark all warnings as technical debt and exclude them from the future analysis results. This way you can continue to write and change the code as normal without being distracted by warnings issued for old code. To find the detailed instructions on how to set up this mechanism, check our video. Well, the analyzer is now successfully deployed and incorporated into the development process. What's next? How do you prove that your project complies with MISRA? You need to go through several stages of preparation. The first and foremost thing you need to do is to train your development team. Specialists who develop embedded projects should have special training in the use of the chosen programming language for embedded applications, the chosen programming language for high integrity, safety related, and security related systems. You also need to establish a uniform coding style, choose a suitable compiler and analysis utilities. After that, you can move on to all sorts of paperwork. Yes, all this bureaucracy is inevitable. So, what exactly do you need? The developer and acquirer should agree on a Guidelines for Categorization Plan, GRP. GRP is a set of acceptable shifts from one level of guidelines to the other. This is how GRP looks as a table. From the table, we can see what advisory rules may not be checked for compliance, what advisory rules can be recategorized as required or mandatory, what required rules can be recategorized as mandatory. Suppose we have the 1.1 rule whose level is required. According to the table, we can raise the warning level to mandatory or leave it as is. It's displayed with green cells. At the same time, lowering the level to advisory or disapplied is not allowed. It's displayed with red cells. After GRP, we move on to the Guidelines Compliance Summary, GCS. The GCS includes an entry for each guideline and records the level of compliance with it as permitted by its MISRA category. The rules number and its default category are taken from the standard. Next, you apply the ready-made GRP to the categories and change them if necessary. Based on the resulting categories, you can specify rule compliance. Here's what we need to do. If code fragments don't exactly comply with the rules, we fix them. If the guideline violation is acceptable, we mark rules as deviation. However, this applies only for required or advisory rules. Note that you must justify and document the deviation of each required rule. If necessary, we can ignore rules that fall into the advisory category, since they are non-obligatory. And finally, to determine whether your project complies with the standard, we need the following table. If your project hits the red zone at least once, that means your project does not comply with the standard. Well, you wrote the code that follows the MISRA rules. You've made a compliance plan and documented everything that could be documented, and you filled out your compliance resumes. The code of your program is clean, readable, and reliable. Congratulations! Where will your program live now? In an MRI device? In an ordinary speed sensor? Or in the system of some space satellite? Yes, you've been through a serious bureaucratic path, but it's minor. How not to be scrupulous? These are real human lives at stake. Do you want to learn more tips on programming and improving your code? Welcome to our channel! See you in the next video!